On behalf of the Harlem Cultural Archives Historical Society, I want to thank you for joining us on this Saturday afternoon to honor Harlem icon, Dr. JohnL.S. Holloman Jr. I was fortunate enough to know him personally. His office was in the building I grew up in the Riverton. I wanted to start from how this got started. I want to thank the people who actually signed the petitions, the community organizations that provided us with letters of support, such as the Riverton Tennis Association, Youth Education Through Sports, Local 372 of the DC 37, Congressman Rangel, Congressman Keith Wright, the Mid-Manhattan branch of the NAACP, all provided us with letters of support for this particular event. Community Board 11 was the community board that actually made it happen and made the recommendation to Inez Dickens, whose office was able to come up and make it all happen with the signs and all the paperwork. I'd also like to thank the people from Harlem Hospital, Ms. Sylvia Wright, Chief of Staff, and Chris Ndagwe. Chris, I want to thank you for everything. He helped us set everything up. I'd like to thank my brother, Keith Hunter, my partner, Ken Sargent. I'd like to thank people who've been supporting me all the way, supporting us, my daughter Leanne and Lauren, who are at the desks greeting you, as well as my wife, Audrey, driving her crazy for the last couple of weeks. I want to thank the Holloman family for letting us do this. This is really an honor. I mean, it's kind of a mutual good time. I mean, just the fact that they're allowing us to do this is an honor to us because Dr. Holloman was so special. I want to recognize the folks from the Second Avenue Baptist Church who came all the way from D.C. just to be here. And I'd also like to thank a special friend of mine who, he didn't know it, but he's officially on our Board of Trustees. His name is Glenn Blacks. It's the handsome gentleman over there in the suit. He's our newest trustee. We want to thank him. He's been doing a lot of the heavy lifting for us, and we couldn't have gotten here without him. So just to give you a little history about our organization, our motto is Harlem to the World. Since 2008, we've been recognizing Harlem icons on a yearly basis to make sure that history gets it right. We want to make sure our history is told properly and it's told with the right flavor, if you know what I mean. In order to do this correctly, we want to make sure that we let you know that we can't do it by ourselves. You know, we're looking to the community for content in the form of artifacts, people you think we can be interviewing, any pictures you may have, any old videos you may have. We're trying to also spread our wings a little bit and incorporate other facets of community history, such as landmark preservation. So that's something that we're going to take a serious look at and find out how to do that correctly, and so that we don't lose our landmarks. Okay. Of course, if for any organization to do this properly, you're going to need some financial support, and I've seen that's what those envelopes in the program were for. Again, we want to do this right. I was just talking to gentleman Russell Schuler from Youth Education Through Sports. I said, you know something, Russell? We have to do this right. We can't mess this up. So our history is that important, and we want to make sure that it's done correctly. Okay, I'd like to introduce the Master of Ceremonies. My best friend in the world. It's my brother, Dr. Keith Hunter. Thank you.
Somebody separated from their earring. So if you miss an earring, we will leave it up here on the table for you. That's that Holloman spirit of giving right there. Want to again give a real shout out to the folks from the Second Baptist Church. Could y'all stand up or recognize y'all here from D.C.? The church was Dr. Holloman's father's church. The Reverend John L.S. Holloman Sr. was pastor of that church in D.C. for 52 years. It was founded in 1848 as the Second African Baptist Church in the District of Columbia. They stopped on the Underground Railroad. Is there a historic for some? So please, one more time for the church. I've got a tall task. I'm gonna try to do the best I can. If I make mistakes, just correct me. I'm really easy with that criticism. But we want to make sure we're gonna introduce members of the family and have them all stand at the same time. I'm just gonna mention those who are here and do the best I can. If I get it wrong or miss anybody, please tell me and I'll try to correct. In the audience is Pat Holloman, Charlotte Holloman, Ellen and James Hirsch, Jessica Jackson and Jackie Jones, Grace Holloman Davis, Francisco Borges, Paul Leo, his family members Naomi, Stefan, and Sophie's, and Pat Roberts. So what we're going to try to do is do small pieces of Dr. Holloman's life. You know, a man, a giant like this, you can't do it all in a short period of time. So we're not going to try to do that. We're going to have, you know, selected people who said they're willing to say a few words, come up and say a few words. And Charlotte and I met 10, 15 years ago in D.C. as part of the station board for a radio station that has very progressive ideas like her and her dad. It's a labor of love because things don't get resolved for a long period of time, but you know, you try your best to do a good thing. Charlotte was the chairman of the board and took a lot of heat, but she hung in there, and I kind of know where she got her grit from her dad. All right, and fortunately, yesterday, Charlotte invited me up to the pavilion at Howard University Hospital where Mrs. Charlotte Holloman is in the hospital. She's doing okay, but you know, she's convalescing for a couple of days before she comes home, so she couldn't make it today. So I'm making a couple of comments during the proceedings of kind of things that she did mention. But first I want to bring up Mrs. Pat Holloman and say a few words.
Of a historic and beautiful community that has contributed so much to New York City, to our nation, and is known all over the world. I could talk about Lawrence Holloman for hours or days, and I'm sure many of you could as well. I just wanted to say that he was as good as he was handsome. He was a son, a brother, a father, a husband, a friend, a physician, a warrior, a teacher, and more. He was my hero.
you very much. And in keeping with the family vibe, we're going to ask Dr. Holloman's sister, Ms. Grace Holloman Davis, to bless us with a few words.
Good afternoon.
I am pleased to have this opportunity to say just a word about Lawrence Monroe. He was a wonderful person, not only in public life, but at home. He was a brother to be admired and loved. My father went to Washington, in 1917 with three little girls. And Lawrence and I were born in Washington a little while later. And so we are Washingtonians, they were North Carolinians. We had a wonderful childhood. Lawrence went to Dunbar High School in Washington, D.C. and left there to go to Virginia Union University, where he later served for 20 years as chairman of the Board of Trustees. I don't know whether you knew that as well. He served New York on the SUNY board, as well as his loving, generous work in Harlem. He served too. He comes my nephew through the door, Jason Holloman Parker. He served the community and the nation. Just last week in our local newspaper, we had a picture of the commemorating the march from Selma. And that picture has appeared in many black publications, I guess, and some others as well. But Lawrence is on the road just behind Dr. Martin Luther King in the Selma March. There's a man with a white shirt and black tie, and Dr. Holloman is just the left as you look at him in that picture. I'm not sure whether Pat put that photograph up there, but it was repeated in our Washington Informer just 2 weeks ago as Black History concluded. I remember Lawrence so well as a wonderful. I was the only sister, young. My mother assigned him a task of taking care of me. So he had to, it was many times Saturday, he had to take me along when he went on whatever the adventure was. And he provided wonderful, wonderful support. I hope you will remember him as he was a wonderful and loving, caring,
giving individual. Thank you. It's so wonderful to have Dr. Holloman's sister here. And like I said, I was talking with Mrs. Charlotte Holloman yesterday in the hospital, and she had mentioned how when they had come to the Riverton, they were actually speaking to Clifford Alexander. Anybody that's not really history of Riverton, I'll put in a plug for Harlem Cultural Archives. Our videographer and artistic director, Ken Sargent, did a wonderful documentary called Down by the Riverside, and parts of it are on our website, and you can check it out at harlemcultural.org. Riverton was set up as a housing location for for returning black GIs. And it was you know, the first time they'd ever done something like that in Harlem. And Dr. Holloman was kind of recruited by Clifford Alexander, who was the director of Riverton at that time. And apparently the family lived in 2160, which is my building for a while, as Dr. Holloman said, in his office downstairs. All right, I'm gonna have one of my friends, Charlotte Holloman, come say a few words. Like I said, Charlotte is a very serious activist in her own right. We met doing great work in D.C. Come on, Charlotte.
I was born in Sydenham, which no longer exists. But my mother and I lived in the Riverton. We lived in 2160. My father, of course, was there. And we lived in an apartment up on the 10th floor. And my father had his office down on the main floor. He also had there, subsequent to that, a laboratory. And my mother talked to Keith about the laboratory yesterday and how they had developed a test, a pregnancy test, and the office became so crowded with women who wanted this pregnancy test. And my mother was teaching during the day and working in my father's office in the evening. But she couldn't accommodate all of the people who would come in after work, and many of them women, because they wanted this new pregnancy test. So he opened up a laboratory primarily to accommodate that overflow. We didn't stay in Riverton very long. When I was about 6 years old, we moved out to Queens, but we were always back and forth. I learned how to ride a bicycle. So 2160 is very special to me. I come to Harlem from time to time, but I had not been to Riverton until just a few minutes before I came here. And I was shocked at the changes. I mean, absolutely, it's just over the years it has, let me see how I can put this, matured. I was talking to Dr. Dayson, who took over my dad's laboratory when he went into public health and became president of the New York City Health and Hospitals Corporation. And I asked him, I said, are you still practicing in the Riverton? And he said, no. He said, they raised the rent and I had to move. He said it was $3,500 and it went up to $7,000. So I said, okay, I guess you did move. But anyway, I'm very happy to be here. I, you know, have been wondering what my father would think about this. He was a very modest man. And he deserved all of the accolades that he got. And you know, certainly I think that he deserves this one, but I'm not quite sure what he would think of it. But anyway, I'm so glad you all came. And I'm so very pleased that Keith and Glenn were his patients, and Ken, and were his patients when they were boys. And he made such a tremendous impression on them that they thought to do this. So anyway, thank you again, and carry on.
Again, Dr. Holloman's spirit is strong in Charlotte, and we are really thankful that she allowed me to talk to her mom yesterday. She also told me that while they were working at the office, that Mrs. Charlotte Holloman actually worked in the office for a while until it was time for her to go to grad school, and she was at Columbia Teachers College in music education. As an aside, Mrs. Charlotte Holloman is a very, very well-renowned performer, operatic singer, and she has taught generations of Howard University graduates in music. All right, we're kind of moving through family folks here, and I'd like to see if maybe Jessica Jackson could say a few words. She said she didn't have a whole lot prepared, but that's okay.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Am I good? All right. I want to thank the Harlem Cultural Archives for putting together this occasion this afternoon. Uncle Lawrence is my mother's brother. And I have a little bit of a different take on family life. There are kind of two waves of Holloman generations, and I'm in the second wave. And I kind of came along and matured with Aunt Pat and Paul and Ellen and Laura and Aaron. And so my memories of Uncle Lawrence are just so wonderful and so fantastic because he brought these people into my life, and all of it was just an amazing adventure. My strongest memories are Martha's Vineyard. You guys remember Martha's Vineyard? No. What happens in Martha's Vineyard stays. And I remember the porch, I remember Max the Wonder Dog. I remember Uncle Lawrence coming home from the city and those moments. I'm gonna confess something. I don't think Aunt Pat realizes that I was watching, but they would spend evenings on the porch together. She would cut his hair. And the love between them and the intimacy between them was something that I carry forward. It's a quality that I seek in my own life, in my own relationships. And so I want to thank you, and I hope that my spying on you was an okay thing. Perfectly. Thank you. Uncle Lawrence taught me how to water ski, and those were the kinds of afternoons we would have. Lake Candlewood, remember Lake Candlewood? And so, when I think about all of the momentous and wonderful and amazing ways that Uncle Lawrence changed the world, I don't want to forget that he really, you know, moved us to be better adults and to continue to hold our family tight, to love each other, and to continue to grow as we get to take those values forward into our children's lives. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you very, very much, Jessica. That was great for impromptu. That was excellent. A little bit more about from Mrs. Holloman, that they were living in Jamaica for a while. And again, Dr. Holloman was known for opening the office late at night so that folks in the community who had to work would see him in the evening, which is, you know, just another testimony to his greatness. We're going to kind of take a quick shift, and we're going to intersperse some other people, non-family. We're not going to forget family, come back to that. But one family member who did arrive recently is Dr. Jason Park. Maybe you can just raise your hand over here. He just came in, another family member. Last year around this time, we had another naming ceremony, part of the same general energy, if you will, around Riverton for Dr. Billy Taylor. Dr. Taylor's daughter and wife are here right now. Kim, could you just get a couple of words for us, please?
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How you doing today?
Very well.
Isn't it wonderful to be here for Dr. Holloman?
Mm-hmm.
right? You know, when I think about Mike Holloman, I think about a man who lived his politics. He was somebody who took care of us at every level that he could. It wasn't something that was an afterthought. Taking care of us was front and center. I was a friend, a family friend, and a patient of Dr. Holloman, and to this day, he's my favorite doctor on the planet. The man could give a needle, couldn't he? It never hurt. He never hurt you once. He was just lovely. But when I think about Dr. Holloman, I think about all of the things that he did for us as a community. On the national stage, he helped found the Medical Committee for Civil Rights, which was the medical arm of the civil rights movement. And we've just heard how we've just celebrated the march from Selma to Montgomery just recently. And we all remembered Dr. King at the front of that march. But far too few of us remember that Dr. Holloman was there taking care of folks. Charlie Rangel once said that Dr. King was leading the march, but Dr. Holloman was taking care of our feet in that march. He just took care of us and made sure we were okay. Mike was one of the good doctors who not only saw that he needed to be there for the average folks, but that he needed to be a voice for those of us who didn't have a voice in some of those hallowed halls where they were making decisions that affected us. He became a leading voice attacking practices, racist practices, of the American Medical Association. He actually exposed the AMA's support of medical organizations that would not treat black folks. And he took that front and center and made sure that the AMA knew that they had to stop that practice. So he exposed the hypocrisy of a national organization that claimed to be interested in promoting the health of all, but were only interested in promoting the health of some. He took care of us. Mike went on to lead the National Medical Association and head the Health and Hospitals Corporation, and he fought hard battles on our behalf. And sometimes I think they probably took a toll on his spirit and maybe his health. But that was who he was. I knew all of that about him, but it makes me proud, and it makes me proud to know that he did all those things. But those aren't the things I remember most about him. I remember Mike as a family friend who wouldn't let us pay for our medical care. At that time, you know, now my dad is remembered as a renowned jazz musician, but at that time he was a struggling jazz musician. And he wouldn't let us pay for our medical care. And at one point, Mom just said, I'm going to send him a check because he's been taking care of us for free. And a week later, that check came right back in the mail to us. He just wouldn't take it. I remember going into his office, and it was always full of folks. There were comfortable couches and chairs. I remember as a kid that he had the Highlights magazine in there that every kid loved to look at. And it was the thing that kept you occupied and kept your mind off of feeling sick. I also remember that that waiting room always had the soap operas on, right? It seemed like every time I was in there, The Days of Our Lives was on. It was like there were no other stories. It was the NBC stories or nothing. But Dr. Holloman was good to us. And I actually love that the street that's going to be named after him is going to be near my dad's, because they went to Dunbar High School together. And when Mike went off to Virginia Union, my dad went off to Virginia State. But they became fast friends and stayed friends. And I'm glad that they're going to be side by side again. Mike lived his politics. He took care of us. And even though it might have embarrassed him, he will never be forgotten. Thank you very much.
And that was very, 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 very wonderful. I really appreciate that. Okay, we're going to keep moving through. Another organization that Dr. Holloman was proud to be a part of, the Alpha Phi Alpha organization, and there's a representative from that organization here today going to say a few words for me, Mr. Sean Gale.
Thank you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How are you guys doing today? My name is Sean Christopher Gale. I'm the president emeritus of the Wall Street chapter of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated here in New York. I'm going to mention just a couple of quick things about Dr. Holloman that probably, maybe just a few of you know, but this will also help to be able to show what type of a multifaceted individual Dr. Holloman was. Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated has a few members you may have heard of before, of course, Charlie Rangel, David Dinkins, Adam Clayton Powell, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Thurgood Marshall, and of course, Dr. Holloman. And Dr. Holloman certainly should be considered as one of the luminaries, like I just mentioned, especially considering so many of them were important, not so much just for America as a whole, but of course in New York City in particular. And Dr. Holloman, of course, was the president of the chapter of Alphas here in New York. He was also the president of the chapter at his beloved Virginia Union. It's important for me because I went to Howard University, our second chapter, Beta Chapter. A week later, the chapter of Virginia Union was founded, Gamma Chapter, which he was the president of. Our particular chapter is a rather storied, and it's very important to be able to note that it was very humble, but still was surrounded by very important people that cared a lot about giving. The three most important tenets of my fraternity are manly deeds, scholarship, and love for all mankind. And Dr. Holloman just exemplified that at every turn, between graduating cum laude or serving in the military and the army. Of course, being the chairman of the medical committee of not just of the civil rights movement, but also for human rights. I mean, he was extremely well balanced. And one thing that's very interesting about my fraternity in particular is that even though we do have a number of luminaries surrounding us, and we do some really great public things internally, we have a lot of criticism for each other. We're always trying to figure out, well, what are you doing lately? And how much better are you doing than me? I checked some of our archives. We have a national organization, national magazine called The Sphinx. And I checked some of our archives to see a little bit about Dr. Holloman. He was in there numerous times. If you just indulge me a minute, I just want to read a little bit from one of the most recent, most powerful times he was in that magazine. Being able to showcase just how important he was, not so much just for the community, but also for us as Alphas in particular. He says, if healthcare is to have a real meaning in the United States, it must be planned for, fully comprehensive, easily accessible to patients when they require care, both for the preventive and curative care. Prepaid group practice meets the challenge admirably. Now he said that as he was installed as the vice president, of course, of New York Health Plan. And it was featured pretty prominently in the magazine, very much next to all the other brothers who were Brothers of the Year, and a picture of Brother King was on the front cover. But it really should just underscore the fact that even though he was very beloved in the community, certainly here in Harlem, certainly within the military and beyond with the civil rights movement, we also very much look up to him within the fraternity, even amongst those of us who are, you know, pretty powerful individuals ourselves, because he didn't just talk about it, he lived it. So I want to say thank you to Ms. Holloman for inviting me to come speak a little bit today. And thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to be able to recognize the life of somebody who mattered and who showed us how to matter. Thank you.
All right, thank you. That was Mr. Sean Gale, representative from the Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. Going to go back into some family folks. And I'm going to see if Ellen can come say a few words.
Honored we are for this, and how much we appreciate it, and grateful we are. It's wonderful to see you all. As I was growing up, I always knew that my father was special, always. But his achievements in civil rights and for the causes of justice are very well known, and there are not many people who were able to do the things that he did. But he was my father, and I thought he was special for other reasons. And I just wanted to share a little story about him. From a perspective that maybe not everyone has. I'll tell you about the time that my father performed a miracle. When I was in the third grade, I was always afraid of going into the fourth grade because it was governed by the most fierce teacher in my school, Mrs. Sergi. I remember her to this day. I could hear her voice in my head. She would shout at students. She would throw chalk. There were no excuses. You couldn't go to the bathroom until you had a given break. Very stern. So when I finally got into her class, it was always very intimidating. And I got in trouble one day in school. And I don't remember exactly what it was, but some mischief. There was two or three other students with me. And a parent had to get involved. And for whatever reason, my mother wasn't available to me, so it had to be my father. And I was just terrified. I didn't know what would happen next. So we came to school, and we went to a closed door meeting, and I was just waiting for the axe to fall. And I didn't see him go, but I saw Mrs. Sergi come out, and she looked at me, and I was just waiting for the thunderbolt. And she smiled. I saw her teeth. I don't think anyone had ever seen her teeth. She smiled, and not another word was said, except one other thing. It was a few days later, I was doing something, I was at my desk, and she was watching me, and she knew what happened. And she put her hand on my shoulder. This fierce little woman with wonderful white hair. And she said, "You know, your father is just so handsome." And then she walked away. And it was a miracle. I thought I was done. My scholastic career was over in the fourth grade. He made it right. I don't know what he said, but I'm sure he was his usual, wonderful, charming self. And my father is an enormous hero to me. I know he's an inspiration to everybody in this room. I'm just so grateful to have this honor. And I know, again, I wanted to reiterate what's said. He might have been a little bit embarrassed by this, but he would be tickled and he would have been delighted to see you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, sometimes it's hard to believe that somebody of this stature does have time for their daughter, and that's really wonderful. Somebody who Dr. Holloman worked with for many years at the Ryan Center is Ms. Barbara Minch. She's immediate past CEO, and she's a wonderful person. I've worked with her as well. Ms. Minch, please say a few words.
What I remember about Dr. Holloman. He was a Ryan for many, many years. In fact, he was a Ryan till the day he died. I remember visiting him in the hospital. Ellen, you remember when you walked in what you were wearing? She had a red afro wig. She had come on the train, a mini skirt to here. And he was in bed, and he went, and she hasn't changed, which is wonderful. At the beginning of the, I've been thinking some of the things he could admire, millions of things, but two that stand out. At the beginning of the AIDS epidemic, we at Ryan had mostly uninsured and Medicaid, a small amount of insured. And we were hearing the stories of how insurance companies would leak it and people were losing their houses, people with AIDS. It was horrible. And a committee was set up to decide how do we handle that, to protect the patients. And they met, well, you know what committees do, you know what you get from a committee. And Mike said, "This is easy. We won't bill." And that's what we did. We got the bill for the private insurance. The other thing is, when Reagan finally decided to address that there was an AIDS epidemic in the United States, he presented before his committee. And he was the first one who said, "This is not just a gay disease," because at the time that's the community that people thought it was in. He said, "This is going to hit communities of color all over." And people thought it was nuts, and we all know the end of that story. Not only, he was like a sea of calm. My former boss and I were like hyper. Mike Chillis, calm down. I come in his office, I was telling him that, hysterical. You don't know what happened. It's one of the doctors. He said, "Oh, you're perfect." perfume smells so nice.
And then I couldn't, what do you say? I went, oh, okay.
I saw him get livid once with a doctor. Otherwise, he would charm them to do what they had to do. One of the substance abuse programs in the community called and said they had a kid who they got a slot for in a, what do you call it? Not a day program. Sleepaway. Inpatient, down south. And they had transportation for him, escorts for him. He needed a physical. It was about 4:45. It wasn't on one of our late nights. And I said, I'm there, I'm feeling it as I'm telling you this. The doctor refused because it was 4:45. And she wasn't going to stay. The kid would have lost the slot. We got the call from the clinic manager, Ruby Brown, who I hope they're talking to each other up there. And he said, let's go. We went down to the area, the clinic area. This was in the old way. Everything was in one big room before we built our new center, which Mike was very instrumental in getting for us. And he went over to her and he said, I never heard this out of him. So stern, you will see the patients. And he grabbed my elbow and said, let us go. She saw the patient. But I felt like the walls were caving in and he didn't even yell. It was, you got that, Ellen?
Yeah.
I miss him very much. Still, it was the... We've had a couple of good medical directors, Ryan. Nobody came near him. In principle, in quality, he cared about quality before doctors started getting incentives, paid to give quality medicine. I said, I'll do it, maybe. I have no faith in the medical system of this country. Sorry. But Ellen, stop kicking him. I'm trying to hold it together. He also was very helpful to me as a human being. I was raising my kids by myself. It was tough. And he would always calm me down when I was hysterical. My son didn't come home and he was in Coney Island and he was 12 years old. They left him on the school trip by himself. Things like he would calm me down. Let's figure out what we're going to do. When my son got very ill, he got involved and he told me, I never crossed a picket line in my life. And he told me I had to because my son was post-op and I had to go every morning to see the doctor. How do I, my father was one of the founders of the night. How could I cross that picket line? So I called one of the VPs and I said, I was told it's okay. And they said, you better cross. Your son's health would be jeopardized. I still miss him. It was very weird when he left. I wouldn't let anyone go in the office. Pat knows. Wouldn't let anyone go. That office was sacred. And it was only about 2 years ago that we finally let it be used because it was Dr. Holloman's office and that was it. And I'm glad that this is being done for him. I wonder how he would feel about some of the changes in the Harlem happening too rapidly. The housing, we all know, is horrendous. Getting an apartment if you're not here for 100 years. The fancy restaurants that I don't know who can go from the community, the new people. So I just don't know how he would feel about it. But I have a feeling you would go what he did to Ellen.
Yeah, that was Barbara Mitch. She was has been a stalwart in healthcare for a long time. Helped with many
great things at the Ryan Center. I worked there for a brief time. And, you know, so my story was that I got some funding from the United States government to work in the public health service while I was in med school. So that was a way to kind of shave some of your costs. So by the time I started, public health service was kind of, you know, robust and going well. By the time I finished, things had changed quite a bit. So there was a possibility of me having to go work in Region 5, which is like Wisconsin, where my dear friend Dan was in school. And I told myself delivering cows or something. I didn't know how that was going to work out. So, make a long story short, I talked to Dr. Holloman. Dr. Holloman said, go talk to Charles Rangel. And Charles Rangel and Dr. Holloman found a way to get me to work at the Ryan Center for a couple of years. So, my father was this. Overjoyed. He couldn't see me in Wisconsin, even though Danny did very well. A couple of more things about Dr. Holloman from the conversation with Mrs. Holloman yesterday. Dr. Holloman was also kind of, at wartime, was brought in, and correct me if I'm wrong, brought in under a special scholarship kind of situation because they needed docs. And he got the scholarship done. But when he went into the military, of course, the military had its own segregation problems, but finally got his way to working with the Air Force. Dr. Holloman also had a couple of very famous clients, patients, but I'll talk about him a little bit later. Dr. Holloman had treated thousands of patients at Harlem Hospital. He had also trained hundreds of residents. And if you've never been in medicine, and I guess most of us have had medicine on one side, but if you're like in training, training is like daunting. It's like you don't sleep, you know, you don't eat right, you know, you don't never know enough, you're reading all the time, you're tired, all this kind of stuff. But it's something that we all go through, and you know, you're better for it because you realize the weight of responsibility is that you've got to take care of somebody else. So, after seeing hundreds of residents, there was one he chose to take over his practice. Don Basin. Come on. Say a few words. Don speaks very softly, so you have to listen real carefully. But he's an extremely erudite brother, and he's also in the political line, genealogy of Dr. Holloman. Don Basin.
Okay. Okay, gotcha. Okay. My name is Don Mason. I shared office space with Dr. Holloman from 82 to 95. And I have to say, Dr. Holloman gave me a compliment. In my application, there was a question about how, what person do you look up to? And I said, my youthful arrogance, I don't look up to any man. But I met somebody who had five Malcolm X and the strength of Martin Luther King. I could start looking up to that guy. And then I met Mike Holloman. And I made it right ever since. It starts out slowly, you know. Mike didn't really tell you that in the 50s, he had a celebrity practice, you know, Sammy Davis Jr., Muhammad Ali, Miles Davis, John Coltrane, Paul Robeson, some of his clients, you know. Shilgray Robinson used to give him $10,000 to say, okay, Mike, see people, and that's what he did. And didn't know all about the celebrity part, but he knew a lot about show life. You know. When I was studying for my board the first year that I was in the office with him, the phone would ring at midnight. I was finished seeing my patients, and you know, not fast. Okay. And the phone would ring at midnight. Is Dr. Holloman coming in? Sir, madam, it's midnight. I know it's Dr. Holloman coming in. You know. Because of midnight, you know, and he was the doctor to celebrities. all the time and he was always available to me. Speeding it up, you know, somewhere along, he got involved with the civil rights movement. There's a picture over there in Selma, you know, and that's where you would have Ann Arbor. Okay. And, you know, we all know about, we see the pictures about people getting hit by the police, the cops, whatever you want to call them. But what happened when the cameras went off? If you were a doctor, a health practitioner trying to help someone who was in a demonstration, you would run out of town. So what Mike would do, afterwards, he would arrange for doctors to come and health practitioners to come to take care of people after the demonstration. But that's when he has the softened, you need a little bit of help, you know. And if you can't find a doctor or a nurse to take care of you, you're a little bit up to people. But thank you, Pat. That was very helpful. You know, he speaks wildly about that. And he always told me to always remember him. You know, did you know that Mike was an advocate for children's doctor? Clayton Powell was the congressman that pushed through Medicare and Medicaid in 1965. And, you know, there's another picture over there with Mike walking on a boardwalk in 64 with the AMA, 63, where he was in the AMA to integrate the AMA, JohnL.S.HollomanM.D, Mike. You know, small little thing. You don't see that in the history of this. You know, I, you know, during my internship and residency, we had a citywide strike for patient care to improve health care in public hospitals. You know, we all know, church, we all know what we're supposed to be doing. We all got involved. We knew all the plans. 2-3 o'clock in the morning, we're arguing about how shall we run this plan? How shall we run this strike? You know, here it is 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, you're a young turd, you got juice. And then walks Mike. You know, 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, what is this old guy doing? And one of the unique things that your father had, you know, he could take 20 people. We're all juiced about what we want, what we think is the right thing. And he'd listen to all of us. You know, get very calmly and start talking. And he would weed something positive you said. And by the time he finished talking, he thought that we were all in agreement. You know, one of the reasons why Harlem Hospital took care of our patients during that strike. Mike tried to get this done at all the other hospitals because he arranged for us to have attendants take care of patients while we were out striking because he said, you've got to strike. The thigh would come up, you would see the thigh, but very calm, always very calm, you know. And you talk about someone being a little bit ahead of his time. In 82, he had me convinced that I should go to China to learn acupuncture. Somewhere along the line, knew that who was organizing the study of acupuncture would take traditional Chinese doctors, traditional Chinese Western doctors, and then having the Chinese doctors and the Western doctors work together. 10,000 in one group, 10,000 in the combined group, 10,000 in the Western training group. You know, something like a great study. Reagan pulled the money from it. You know. And I don't know who was going to be in China. But he had to persuade the time. And I know we didn't make that up. He was also FDA commissioner. You know, this single-payer natural health insurance is something he's always fought for. He talked to John Conyers. There's a House Bill 676. Conyers has introduced that bill since 1990. Single-payer Medicare for all. You know, that would be something that Mike would be fighting for because he knew that access to health care is a way to keep our communities healthy, you know. And you would see fire very quiet father, as he talked about. And one last thing, talking about AIDS, you know, I thought the Rhine Center was a model for taking care of AIDS. You know, it was something that Mike put together. And, you know, and I ran my practice like that, you know, my private practice. A lot of people thought that I was an AIDS doctor because I worked at the Rhine Center, because the stuff that I learned from Mike. A new disease we've never seen before, with no treatment, you know. And, you know, us young turkeys think we knew something. But Mike was on the curve ahead of us all. So, you don't know how, you know what, quick to my next solution. How did I do this? You know, and he's always calm about some fantastic things that he's done, but always quiet. You know, he's going about it.
Dr. Jason is one of the best people you'd ever want to meet. Anybody looking for a really caring healthcare practitioner's office on 116th Street. He's not that tall. Somebody who worked with Dr. Holloman, Ms. Bowe, who actually was an employee of his in the latter part of his multifaceted career. Now tell us a few things about Dr. Holloman.
Actually, how I know Dr. Holloman is through Pat Holloman and his wife. I started working in Health and Hospitals Corporation at Bellevue Hospital in January of 1978. And understanding and being brought up from my mother in terms of understanding the importance of access to care. The fact that if you want a productive society, you have to have equal access to care as well as education. In understanding the importance of that and looking at activism is how I met Pat Holloman through the New York State Nurses Association. I also was subsequently introduced to Dr. Holloman's activism in terms of I never like to use the word fight, because sometimes people use that word as you have this negative framework or whatever, but the idea of activism in the truest sense of facilitating a true product, an end result that's going to be the best for all concerned. And in meeting Dr. Holloman in his later years, you saw that. He was never lost. His body may have failed him somewhat, but his mind didn't, and the concerns that he presented never left. And I think what he did, and most importantly, was he blazed the road for all of us to follow and to build upon and to make tributaries, to outreach to more people, to bring more people into the concerns with regards to what we all need in terms of that quality of life, that access to care. It was interesting, I never realized that he was president of HHC until I met Pat Holloman. And then when I looked at the brochure that basically recruited me as a staff nurse, I saw Dr. Holloman with Mayor Bean. And it was an interesting picture. But I can't tell you how impressed I am and grateful that he has existed, that he has been there for Health and Hospitals Corporation, and you know what he has done in terms of blazing the role for all of us, not just as an employee, in the sense that I'm now a clinical instructor at Bellevue, but I've also taken a role in terms of New York State Nursing Association and activism, as well as CPHS, the Commission on the Public Health System, which is an activist group that facilitates policy and actually recognized Dr. Holloman for his absolute dedication to that all have access to care. So I'm very grateful to be here today and very grateful to know that a man like him existed and still exists in all of our hearts. Thank you.
Okay, a legacy of activism all the way through. Friend of the family, Mr. Mark Barksdale. Can I say a few words, sir?
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Greetings to the Holloman family, Mrs. Holloman, Dr. Holloman's sister, my friend Charlotte, all the guests, visitors from D.C. and all the other guests here, hello. My name is Mark Barksdale. I wasn't expecting to speak today, but this is kind of an impromptu happening for me. So I just wanted to say a few words about my family's connection to Dr. Holloman. And saying that just about my entire adult life, I've been trying to piece together this story of how my family knew Dr. Holloman. So today was a great day of revelation for me because I've learned things that helped put that story together. And before I arrived here today, I kind of reviewed Dr. Holloman's obituary that was published in the New York Times, so I was able to get a few more bits of information that I can put together with this story. So, as I was saying, there's this connection between my family, the Barksdale family of D.C. I'm a native of D.C., even though my friend Charlotte likes to tell me I'm a New Yorker. I do live in New York, but I was born in Washington, D.C. And my father was born in D.C., and he was born in 1919, the same year as Dr. Holloman. So, conceivably, they were friends, and I knew that my father knew Dr. Holloman. Family knew the Holloman family because my father had three sisters. They all attended Dunbar High School, and their names were Florence, who was named also known as Dilsey, and Harriet, who was known as China, and Thelma. So there was all this connection between, and at that time, the African American community in D.C. was small enough that just about everyone knew everyone else. So there's always been this connection. So I had heard the story just about my entire adult life that when Dr. Holloman moved to New York, he had borrowed my father's car. And I'm telling tales out of school now, but I apologize. My apologies to Charlotte and the Holloman family. So the story was that he had borrowed my father's car to come to New York. And he kept the car so long that my father had to take the train up in New York to get the car back. So there was that connection. But then there was also this other connection that I was speaking to my mother the other day. She was saying that, oh, your father used to work for Dr. Holloman when Dr. Holloman set up this practice here in Holloman. And this was around the time of World War II, and my father had come up to take some kind of training course before he joined the Army. And he was living at the Y in Brooklyn, but apparently he was working for Dr. Holloman, doing something, maybe couriering or delivering things for Dr. Holloman. So they kept that connection from D.C. to New York when Dr. Holloman moved to New York. So that was on my father's side of the family. And I'm very proud to be a Washingtonian and to say that I had this connection with Dr. Holloman because there are a lot of prominent folks that came out of D.C. in that area of D.C., among them being Duke Ellington and Dr. Charles Drew, who was another graduate of Dunbar High School. And even on my mother's side of the family, her mother, speaking about North Carolina, my mother's mother came out of North Carolina. There was a huge race riot in the late 1890s and moved to D.C. with her aunt and uncle, and ended up graduating from the old M Street School, which became Dunbar High School. So there's this long connection on both sides of my family in D.C. On my mother's side of the family also, I have a cousin who used to be a patient of Dr. Holloman, small world. And so another piece of this story that that became clear for me today was the fact that Dr. Holloman used to run this clinic, pregnancy clinical lab. So my cousin, Aisha Kareem, she had been trying to become pregnant for many, many years. And finally, she became pregnant at 45 years of age. And I know now that it was probably because of Dr. Holloman's pregnancy clinic that helped her become pregnant. So, and she produced one child and one only daughter, and that was a miracle for her. So Dr. Holloman was a miracle worker in many, many ways. You know, speaking, going back to D.C. again, my grandfather, Wallace, used to run a couple of restaurants in D.C. in a hotel. And so, as I was saying, you know, this community in D.C., the African American community, is very small, and everyone just about knew everyone else. So I'm sure there was a lot of connections between my family and the Holloman family over the years. Now, just one last connection that I have that I'd like to share with you today is my own personal connection with Dr. Holloman. I did have a chance to meet him once. I was a graduate student at Columbia University studying hospital architecture in 1975, and I was working that summer as an intern for the Department of Health, New York City Department of Health, down on Wirt Street, 125 Wirt Street, which is also where Dr. Holloman had his office when he was president of the Health and Hospitals Corporation. So I had heard all these stories about Dr. Holloman, and I said, oh, I'm going to go right there and meet Dr. Holloman, see whether these stories are true that I had heard all these years. So I tried and tried and tried, and at that time, 1975, Dr. Holloman was going through his battles, trying to save Health and Hospitals Corporation, trying to save his own job. And, you know, he was appearing in the newspapers quite often about all these things going on with the hospital, the cuts and the budget and whatnot. So I said, oh, maybe I won't get to meet him because he's really in battle down there upstairs in his office. But finally, towards the end of the summer, I finally got the opportunity to give an appointment to see him for a few minutes. So I went up to his office, and he was very, very cordial. He didn't say much, but I was so happy to get that opportunity to finally meet Dr. Holloman, who I'd heard so much about. And we sat there and chatted for a little while. And so, you know, I will always remember that opportunity to meet him and how cordial he was to me. So I appreciate that opportunity. So that's it. But I'm just so happy that everyone is here today to remember Dr. Holloman and to honor him. And I give thanks to the Hunter Brothers for putting this program together. And I thank all of you for being here today. And we thank Harlem Hospital for allowing us to be here today. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, sir. Some of the connection between D.C. and Harlem. Continue. Another family member is going to say a few words. Mr. Paul Leo. Happens to be an anesthesiologist like myself, so we have some in common.
Well, thank you everyone for being here. That's been said a few million times, so. I flew in from Denver last night. We had 2 feet of snow on the driveway. It took me 2.5 hours to get out. Unfortunately, it was just raining in Denver, so I was late for the rest of my office before I bought my plane. Louder. I've never been accused of being quiet, but I'll remind you, as an anesthesiologist, I talk to people who are asleep. And let that excuse half of what I'm going to say from here on out. I too was asked to do this a little while ago, and I was actually really happy that I was flying under radar and would not have to say anything. So I've had a couple minutes to put it together, and since most of you have one of these, I'd like you to Google the bridge builder. The bridge builder poem. And do it right now, because when I tried to read it 10 years ago, and I'm a good one. I am a member of Beta Theta Pi fraternity. I still work with them, both upstate at Cornell and in Colorado. And that poem, is something that we read with pledges. And it embodies what we hope people will do. So if you guys do that, then I don't have to try. I think the word that comes to me through this is fortunate, because those of us who knew him were and still are. For the record, I always called him Uncle Lawrence because that's how he was introduced to me. And he was my stepfather. I do not believe in any time that I knew him I was referred to as his stepson. So, in that sense, I am very fortunate to have two fathers, both of whom were great physicians, and that has stood me well in my training and my postgraduate training, and in my interaction with people. Because I deal with a difficult group of people, I do pain management, and there are times when I just have to step out and say, what would they have said? Because I'm about to say something really important. And usually that serves me well. There's a whole bunch of things that I could say, and I'm not willing to try. Because of many memories have been brought up today. But I will go over two of them. One, I think I was about 16, and I was living in California at the time, and I would be here in the summer, and all the Christmases, and at one point, Nick Lawrence took me aside, and he said, if you ever need money for school, you tell Nick. As the politics of a broken marriage worked out, that's who paid for my education. And now a slightly easier memory, and that is Pepper. Any of you who have ever dined with him know that pepper is his favorite food. Whatever goes under the pepper is set. And I can remember being maybe 12 in the apartment in 129th Street, and having just flown in from California, and he took a pepper, and he, or took a steak and bathed it in pepper, and he threw it on there, and I said, I mean, babe, you could not see the thing. And I said, you just ruined that piece of meat. He said, oh no, you'll understand. And these days, I have not tried a scorpion pepper, I have not tried a ghost pepper, but I hang out with a group of people who horrible thing is to eat the hottest pepper you possibly can and just watch the sweat beat out of your face. So, of many of the worlds that were open for me, that was one of them that day. Thank you again, and have a great day.
All right, so we're doing pretty good on time, and Miss Pat wants to say a few more words, a couple of recollections, I guess, you know, because like you say, your history file is so deep, something rings, and you got to say a couple more words, so come on.
I was operating under the standard of say something fast and sit down. So I did, but I ended with idea that he was my hero, and he was. Listening to people talk about it, there are a few things that people should know that aren't always mentioned. One, he did a did many things, and he was a hero because of all the things people have said. He lived what he said he thought and believed, and that's really important, because lots of people get up and you would follow them up to the flame, and then you would find out that they were three blocks behind you. So he was really important that way. But something, he was also an activist in the sense, not getting people to come together and reach common understandings, but there was a dangerous side to him too. He wanted also, heard about college, and about the army. Well, he actually wanted to be a naval officer. And when he was at medical school at the University of Michigan in 1943, and he was almost finishing up, and the war was blazing on, his whole class went up to the Dearborn Naval Station. And there were two black people in his class. The University of Michigan admitted black people, where that's one of the reasons he didn't want to go to an all-black school, want to go where he would have a different exposure. This is all secondhand now. This is what he told me. And so they always had two black people. Now, that's admirable. They needed two people so they could room together. So people need to know all those things. This is anecdotal, but this is really important. And when I went to that 50th medical school, oh, they all loved these two men, Henry Everett and Lawrence. And one man came up to me and said, you know what? He said, this is fabulous. We used to call them the Gold Dust Twins. And I just looked at him. I don't know who remembers here what the Gold Dust Twins were. It was a soap powder. It came in an orange box with little black babies and angels all over the box. So they were, that's what they were. So that was pretty shocking. But when he got his notice back from the Navy, he was told that the United States Navy could not admit a Negro person as an officer, and they used the fact that he had an overbite as a reason not to. He also was the doctor too when we were in the 60s and we had sit-ins at Columbia and everything. There was the underground, the people, the students, the Democratic Society, SDS. He was the doctor who went to see them. He was involved in the revolutionary aspect of it. He was also a physician who was on the board of the American Committee for Africa and was with a group of people who had decided to contest the sovereignty of Southwest Africa, now Namibia, because they weren't independent. They were being ruled by South Africa. So when they flew in this plane, and it was a bunch, group of people, they started to run out of fuel. And they were told as they were trying to cross over that border that if you land, we'll arrest you. So they landed in the desert somewhere. And he had a price on his head from South Africa. Fortunately, like Jason, your brother was able to help write the Constitution for that country as well. The other thing that he did, which was very interesting, was I'm not a baseball player, so I can't say baseball has been very good to me. But I can say the Civil Rights Movement was very good to me because that's where I met my husband. I met him in Selma at that time. We didn't know each other before, and I then worked in the federal government in a program called the Office of Equal Health Opportunity, where he was also a consultant because the NMA had challenged John Gardner to do something about desegregating hospitals. When Title VI of the 1964 Civil Rights was put into motion, where people were starting to act on it, that is what they used to desegregate hospitals in 1965, and the program went through to 66. And they were very clever because they used Medicare, which was a new program, to say if you're not in compliance, you can't participate in this program. So he was very instrumental in that program, which I came out of my kitchen and was working in the federal government because of my work with the medical committee. But he set up a program all over the country where we went everywhere and worked on this. And it wasn't only with thinking of the Deep South. One of the hospitals out of compliance is Columbia Presbyterian at the time. So it wasn't just, you know, we shaded it a little better up here. I just wanted to say these things, and I said I could talk for hours. because these were the unusual things he did, going into Vietnam, North Vietnam, looking with Cuba. He had an eye for the world, and he was very unusual, but as we all said, he was, a lot of Zelens said, you know, that's my father, well, that was my husband. And so, you know, it was remarkable, but he came home at night and left his clothes around and all the other things that went with him. So I want to thank you all again, but I wanted people to know that because he was not a saint. Just like Dr. King wasn't a saint. I heard his wife berating him for not eating enough. So I can tell you that these people, you have to let them have lives too and know that they were really people, everyday people, that we can all aspire to being some of the things they are. And this kind of story about someone who does these kinds of things needs to be told to young people. They don't know where their history is. And that's why what you do is so important. It's to tell them they have a history right here. You don't have to go somewhere else. This is where many things happen. So thank you for indulging me. So I guess I'm the Alpha and the Omega.
Ask the family just to stand up one more time and give everybody a chance to recognize you. Please, the family. What we're going to do is, I think the photographers want to have the family members come up here and take a picture as a group. We also have, a copy of the street sign, and we're also going to do an unveiling of the street sign a block and a half down 135th Street right after this, okay? So thank you all so much for coming. If you like what the Harlem Cultural Archives is doing, please feel free to support it. You can do something in the envelope that you have. You can also go to harlemcultural.org and use the website as well. Dr. Billy Taylor told Glenn and me one day that the work that we're doing is important. And follow-up comment was that if you don't do it, it will not get done. So all of this has been out of pocket. So if you have any kind of help, we're 501c3, recognized by New York State Board of Regents, all the bona fides, please support us. Thank you.